Pastor Mike here. I recently attended a men's Bible conference. And while I was there, I went to a presentation on old earth creationism. If you're not familiar with that term, it's basically when you take the Genesis account of creation and you meld that with the findings of the modern scientific establishment. And what it results in is a very strange way of understanding the Bible. What it results in is a way of treating the Bible almost like liberals treat the Constitution, right? Like Charlie Sheen treats rehab. He just doesn't treat it right. And old earth creationists don't really treat the Bible right. And so what I wanted to do was I wanted to sort of talk through some of the points that old earth creationists make, some of their arguments, in order to give you more confidence to believe that the Genesis account of creation is trustworthy, it is true, and it's really important for our understanding of the New Testament, particularly when we get to Romans chapter 5, where Paul's contrasting the first Adam and the second Adam, Jesus Christ, right? So old earth creationists universally teach that death preceded the fall, that there was millions of years of animal death, and then God created man. The difficulty with that is the Bible teaches very clearly that death came as a result of sin entering into the picture. And not only that, but when we look at millions of years of death and God saying, behold, it was very good, that doesn't sound very good. Millions of years of brutal animal death, that's supposed to be very good? The proof that it isn't good is when Jesus comes back, one of the things that he destroys is death itself. Right? So death didn't precede the fall. Rather, it came into the picture because of human sin. Human sin threw all of the creation into a state of decay and death. Old earth creationists also teach that the Genesis days of creation aren't actual days, but rather day ages, long periods of time that can accommodate even millions of years. The difficulty with that is that just isn't a legitimate way to read the Bible. Listen to Hebrew and Old Testament scholar Dr. James Barr. James Barr is a liberal. He's no friend of evangelical Christianity, but listen to what he says about this issue. He says, so far as I know, there is no professor of Hebrew or Old Testament at any world-class university who believes that the author of Genesis did not intend to convey a creation that took place in six literal 24-hour days. So he's saying he doesn't know any Hebrew or Old Testament scholar at any world-class institution that doesn't believe that Moses was intending to communicate that the creation happened in six normal 24-hour days. And the reason for that is because there's an underlying construction within the Hebrew Bible. It doesn't really show up in an English Bible, an English translation so well, but it's there nonetheless, and it's important for you to know about. So when the first day of creation happens, which is roughly Genesis 1:4, God creates light, separates the light from the darkness, and says, it was morning and evening, the first day. Well, in the Hebrew text, it uses what is called the cardinal numeral. The cardinal numerals are like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so forth. And so it literally says, it was morning, it was evening, day one. Then, for the rest of the days of creation, it doesn't use cardinal numerals, it uses ordinal numerals. So it says, day one, and then it says it was morning and evening the second day, and the third day, and so forth. Now, here's the thing. There is nowhere in the Bible, ever, anywhere, where the word day, which is yom, when it's quantified with morning and evening, using the ordinal numeral, where it means anything less than a 24-hour day. The proof of that is what Moses says in Exodus chapter 20, verse 11. He says, for in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, and he rested on the seventh day. So Moses' interpretation of Genesis is that God created everything in 6 days, not 6 day ages. It's just nonsense. It's just a terrible way to treat the Bible. And as we move further into the Genesis account, the very basis of the Sabbath, the very basis of the command, is that God rested on the seventh day. So the basis for the week, and by the way, modern scientists have no real account as to why we have a seven-day week and not an 8 or 9 day or 5 day week. Well, we do. Our account is God created the earth in 6 days, and on the seventh day he rested. That's why we have a seven-day week. Older creationists will also try to defend their position on the days of creation by saying that there's a distinction between the verbs bara, which is the verb to create, and the verb asa, which is the verb meaning to make. And what they'll say is that when God uses the verb bara, he's creating things from nothing. Like in the beginning, God created bara, the heavens and the earth. That's God creating everything ex nihilo, from nothing. But when it says that God made man in his image, that's the verb asa, and he's saying, look, God used pre-existing stuff all the time. The difficulty with that is that those two verbs are used interchangeably. And when I was at this presentation, this man went on forever about these two verbs being so very different, and this being the way that they can account for sticking millions of years in the Genesis account. For example, excuse me, in Genesis 2:4, it says this: these are the generations of the heavens and earth when they were created in the day that the Lord God had made the earth and the heavens. So the verb bara and the verb asa, to create and to make, are being used interchangeably here. Another example, Genesis 5:1 says God created man, but Genesis 6:6 says God made man. Well, which is it? You know, did God create him or make him? Well, both, because they mean the same thing, obviously. But even more so, what we should realize is that Jesus had a view of creation, right? In Matthew 18, he just, you know, within the context of marriage, he describes God making man and then man leaving his mother and father and cleaving to his wife. If we think about that and just step back and think about the creation just for a moment, right? God made a man. He didn't make a baby that had to grow up to be a man. And when God took a rib from Adam's side and made Eve, Adam didn't have to wait for Eve to grow up. Rather, both Adam and Eve were made in a state of maturity. They were made in a state of completeness. Similarly, when God created the heavens and the earth, he made them into a state of fullness and completeness. And so if you would have looked at Adam 3 minutes before he was born, you would have said, well, or rather 3 minutes after he was born, you would have said, well, this man's 20 years old. But in actuality, he had just been created. If you would have looked at the garden after God had made it, you would have said, oh man, this garden is probably pretty old. But actually, God had just made it. And so we see, because God created not a baby earth, but a fully mature earth, that the earth was created with age. All that being said, we can really trust this. And just remember, when the naysayers say, you can't really trust what it actually says, what the Bible literally says, just remember, haters are gonna hate.
If you don't seek justice, you probably don't know peace. At least the kind of peace that Jesus brings us on account of belief. I don't know if you've noticed, but there's a direct correlation between your profession of faith and your expressions of grace to the hopeless. Yeah, it's true that all men are broken, but to only help the healthy would make us miss the open wounds that matter the most in those moments.